The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel as written to us by John. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the doors were locked, where the disciples, for fear of the Jews, had been hiding, Jesus came and stood in their midst, and he said to them, "Shalom, peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And he said it again, "Shalom. As the Father has sent me, so I now send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive, they are forgiven them. Whose sins you hold back, they are held back." Thomas, called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples said to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger into the nail marks, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Now a week later, his disciples were again inside, and this time Thomas was with them. Jesus came, although the doors were locked, and he stood in their midst, and now a third time he says, "Shalom." And he said to Thomas, "Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands. Bring your hand close and put it into my side. And no longer be unbelieving, but believe." And Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said to him, "You have come to believe because you have seen. Blessed are those who have not seen and still have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples that are not even written in this book. But these are written that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that through this belief you may have life in his name. This is good news from the Lord. Well, I guess if I was going to try to give a title to what I'm going to try to say, it would be "What Jesus Didn't Say." I don't know if you're anything like me, but if you're anything like me, when your friends let you down, for some terrible reason, you want to let them know about it, don't you? You want to sort of stick in the knife. So I just copied down a few of the things that I, just this morning, that I think I would have said. "Well, where were you?" "Fair weather friends, you guys. You were not there when I really needed you. You bunch of cowards, hiding behind these locked doors. What kind of men are you? The women remind you. We're there at the very end, and the first ones at the tomb in the beginning. Where were you guys? Why should I ever trust you again? It's going to take a long time for you to re-earn my trust. You couldn't take it, could you? As long as I was popular, it was okay. But in the end, you just followed public opinion and wanted everybody to like you, and you went where they went. What a bunch of losers you are." That's what I would have said. But here's what we get. I mean, it's pretty extraordinary. in one breath. And the breath itself is, of course, a replication of the recreation of Adam, who was breathed on at the very beginning. Now he re-breathes the Spirit of God on a new humanity about to be reborn. And in this breathing, he communicates the sharing of his Spirit with them, perfect shalom, or peace, and seemingly total forgiveness. He has no need to punish them. He has no need to remind them of their failures, or in any way, like I would, make them pay. You wonder, do we really understand Jesus? How extraordinarily he loves us and says the love of God is. That God is not a God of recrimination and making us pay. If Jesus is the face of God, we're in luck. This really looks good for all of us. They say, some scholars, that the reason they mention that Thomas's name in Aramaic actually means twin is because he's a stand-in for everybody. He's the twin of every one of us in this room. And Jesus, of course, is the stand-in for God. And so we have the great interface between humanity and God. We coming always with our failures, with our inability, with our slowness and unfaithfulness and disloyalty. He not only says, you know, I forgive you, but he passes it on. And he says, if you don't forgive others, they can't forgive themselves. That's what it means. If you hold back, it will be held back. You are now this mystery of forgiveness yourself. People normally cannot find the grace in their hearts to forgive themselves unless at least one other person breathes on them with a tender love and says, in one way or another, I forgive you. The risen Christ is all about leading humanity, leading us, leading Thomas and the 12 into a future. And brothers and sisters, there is no future. God cannot lead us into the future until and unless you're ready to let go of the past. That's why this forgiveness is so central and tied up with the Easter mystery. But then he even goes further. There's so much in this one.